Heavenly Father, we thank you. We love you. We praise you today. We ask in the name of Jesus that you would just anoint me, Father God, as I give your word. Father, your word doesn't need prayer because your word is already anointed. So we ask, Lord, that you would just bless our hearts, that we would receive. We open them up to you, God. We open up our ears to hear what you would have to say, Father. Speak to us. Lord, I believe that today's word is a now word. It's a word that you're saying to us, Father. So, Lord, we just prepare ourselves. We thank you, Lord. Speak into our life. Give us direction. And we give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise for what's going to take place today. In the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Latham. Appreciate you, man. Amen. Well, good morning, church. Amen. I am excited about today. And let me tell you why I'm excited. Number one, I know that I've heard from God. But number two, what was exciting is that after last week's message, I had quite a few of you. It's been a while since I've had that many people come to me and said, Pastor, you need to do a continuation of last week's sermon. And I appreciated the input, but I also took it to prayer. And as I was praying, the Lord really gave me some things. And I want to speak to you. If you did not hear last week's message, you can always go to YouTube, to our YouTube page, and it's at New Dawn Village. All you have to do is put New Dawn Village in on YouTube on the search bar, and you can pull up all of our sermons. You need to get this sermon. And what we want to talk about, what we want to emphasize and fill in some of the blanks about last week was we are talking about preparation. I want to talk to you, and what the Lord wants to say to you is how to prepare for the seasons that are coming in your life. How to prepare for what's going on in your life. And one of the examples that the Lord gave us, and I'm going to go through this quickly, but it's absolutely so powerful and deep. I want you to go again to Ephesians chapter 6, and we're going to read verses 10 to 20. Famously, this is known as the verses on the armor of God. The armor of God. Now, this is what the word says. Now, remember, I want you to keep the word preparation throughout the theme of everything that we say today, preparation, preparation, okay? And when I use the word preparation, I'm not talking about gloom and doom or any of that kind of stuff. I'm talking about, listen, God has exciting and great things for you, and I believe that with all my heart. But their preparation is very important for whatever we do, amen? So Ephesians chapter 6 says this, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God, and we talked about this last week, so that, everyone say so that, you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. The reason that he's talking to you about armor, the reason why he's using these metaphors of armor, is that so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. The problem and the situation and the place of victory is you overcoming the devil's schemes, the devil's attacks. Did you hear what I said? Now, lift your hand here if you've ever been attacked by the enemy. I hope all your hands go up, because if not, you're Jesus. And you're not him. Come on now. He sits on the throne. He overcame that devil. Of course, Jesus was attacked by the enemy, but he overcame. Amen? He overcame. For our struggle, verse 12, is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. So he's talking about a spiritual warfare. Everyone say spiritual warfare. So we're talking about not attacking with swords and clubs and all these things, but we're talking about a spiritual attack that we face. Verse 13 says, therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. So God says, I'm giving you this armor so that when the attack of the enemy comes, that even after he attacks, you will be able to stand. And even after you've done everything that you can do, you're still going to be standing. We talked about, you know, we used the example last week once again about Rocky and Rocky II. You know, when he after the second round, you know, Apollo Creed broke his nose. And I remember that scene. I love it so much. I've seen it a million times where he looked at Mickey, his trainer, and he said, "I'm not going down no more, Mick." He made a decision, "I'm not going down." And God says, if you put on the full armor of God, you will be able to stand against the attacks of the enemy. Amen? Amen. So verse 14 says, "Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist." The King James Version says, "Your loins girt about with truth." We shared about that last week. "With the breastplate of righteousness in place, with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace." And verse 16 says, "In addition to all this, or above all, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one." Church, let me say this to you. We will all experience the flaming arrows of the evil one. But he did say that I have given you a shield of faith that quenches, it absorbs, it protects you. Amen? I receive the blows of those fiery darts if you raise up your shield of faith. Come on, church. There's an if there. Fiery darts are going to come. But whether we lift up our shield of faith or not is up to us. We need to lift up a shield of faith. Amen? So take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Now I want you to go to verse 18. Now listen, those that I mentioned, you know, we did a study on this last week, so you can go watch the video because I talked about each one of those and how powerful they are. But listen to verse 18. Verse 18 says, "And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people." Pray in the Spirit on all occasions. Now, this is important. We're going to get into this, whether some today or absolutely in the future. But he says, pray in the Spirit on all occasions. There's a reason for that. Let me tell you, and I got a lot of information, and I'm going to try to get it in. But here's what I want to focus on. What determines our seasons? What determines our seasons? We went through some of these last week, and I want to regroup them a little bit. There's a little bit of a change from last week to this week on regrouping that, because we all go through seasons. We all go through different seasons. And so here's the thing. Number one is that these different categories of seeds that we sow, number one is investment. We talked about that, investment. Does the investment that you do affect the season of your life that you will experience? It absolutely does. Investment infects everything. If you invest your finances later in life, when it's time to retire, you will be ready. And I know sometimes that could be a scary thought, or just like, man, why are you bringing that up? I think about that all the time. Let me tell you something. I think about it too. But listen, we have to change our life from thinking to doing. Come on now. I'm with you in the boat. I'm making some changes. I'm looking and just saying, okay, I need to plan more for my future. It's quiet. But you know what? That's not necessarily bad, because we're processing. Come on, investment. You're in the investment that you make determines the season you will experience later on. Amen. Discipline. Discipline causes you to experience seasons in your life that no discipline does. The lack of discipline will cause you to experience seasons in your life different from if you did have discipline. But we don't, in the church world, we don't want to talk about these things. Because you know what? In the church world, we have a little league baseball team mentality. What does that mean? That means everyone gets a trophy. We're going to give a trophy to everybody. You walk in through those doors, everybody gets a trophy just for participating. Come on, church. I don't want to be a participator. I want to hold a ribbon. I want to hold that first place trophy. I want to see something for the efforts that I do. And God has over and over in His Word says, if you do this, I'll do this. And it's awesome. It's freedom. It's not bondage. It's freedom. If you do this, I'll do this. Come on. Let me go back one more time. So what happens when I lift up my shield of faith? What will it do? Quench all what? All the fiery darts of the enemy. What happens if I don't raise up my shield of faith? I'm going to get hit. According to God's word. We're going to get hit. The flaming arrows will come. But here's the challenge. Lift up your shield of faith. Pastor, how do I increase my shield of faith? Listen, first of all, the word is always the thing. The word. The word will increase your faith. There is no way you can listen to me preach about seasons today and walk out of here with less faith about seasons. You can't. You're going to be encouraged. It's going to cause you to think. I've already caused you to think. Some of you are thinking, you know what? I do need to plan for my future. I do need to put a plan in place. I do need to have discipline in my life. Come on now. Get around people that will encourage and strengthen your faith. Come on now. This is good stuff. What determines our seasons? Number three is obedience. The seeds of obedience. There is blessing for obedience. There is blessing for obedience. Let me encourage some people in this place. If you're single in this place and you've been believing for your husband or your wife, listen, be obedient to the Lord. There's blessing for being obedient. There's blessing for waiting on God. There's blessing. He says He'll do it. If you love me, keep my commandments. Obey. Listen, obey. Obedience is way better than sacrifice. Obedience is way better. Have you ever been facing a trial and you gave into the temptation? And yes, you know, whether it was a day later, hours later, whatever, you went to God and said, God, forgive me. Does the blood of Jesus cleanse you and make you clean and make you pure? Yes! You are God's kid. And I want to challenge you. You're not any less God's kid in the middle of that sin than you are obeying what He said. I'm not going to get a lot of amen. Some people are like, oh, no. No, you are not any less God's child in your jacked up situation. But I want to say this to you. Are there consequences for disobedience? Ask a parent. Ask your boss. Ask your landlord. Come on now. Amen. So we want to say that there's consequences for disobedience in every other area except God's stuff. Because, oh, no. God is gracious and loving. Come on now. God is gracious and loving. And you are not any less His child in the middle of your jacked up situation. But there's consequences. And what the devil lies to us, and he says that there is no consequences. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. It's going to be all right. I remember when I was living for God, and I started hanging out with these guys from the gym. I told you this story before. Anyway, you know, I was very careful about the relationships, but then all of a sudden, they was like, hey, come out with us and everything, and I started going out with them, and I was like, yeah, that's okay. There's nothing wrong with going bowling with them. There's nothing wrong with going ice skating. We went ice skating and all this stuff, but all of a sudden, they said, hey, let's go to this club in Miami Beach. And I was like, no, man, I've been delivered from clubs. I didn't tell them that. I'm just saying to myself, I was like, I ain't going to no club. And they told me, they said, no, listen, we go to the club. And he goes, the reason why we go to this club is because they play this crazy music and everyone starts doing a mosh pit. And these guys were all bigger than me. And he says, we take people and we throw them in the middle of the mosh pit. We just take people and fling them, you know. And these guys are 200 pounds plus, every one of them. Bigger than me. I was the smallest one. I was about 194 pounds. And these guys are all huge build. And I was like, man, that sounds like fun. And it was. I went in there and just started chucking people all over the place, you know, and everything. But you want to know something? I remember going out with them one night. And in one night, we go to this club where you can fight your friend. So like you put on boxing gloves. There's a big ring in the middle, and you fight. You can fight anyone you want. You know, it's crazy. You know, so we go to. And that night, my car got towed. I almost fell off of a 100-foot drop, and killed, and all these things. Listen, why? Because the disobedience of knowing I shouldn't be involved in that stuff. Come on now. You hear me? Amen. What determines our seasons? Sacrifice. Sacrifice determines our seasons. You know, and a lot of these coincide and they connect, but sacrifice absolutely determines seasons in our life. Sacrifice. Have you ever started a new company? You know, maybe the first 2-3 years you didn't turn a profit, but you know what? You got to year 4 and year 5 and year 6, and all of a sudden you started turning that profit, and your season changed because you were willing to make a sacrifice. We talked about Althea going to law school. You know what? She'll get out of law school and everything, and God has blessed her with scholarships and all these different things. But you want to know something? Maybe the first couple of years or 3 years, you know, she'll have some, you know, interim job. Who knows? But you know what? It's year 5 and 6 and 10 where those attorneys begin to see that turnover, and they begin to see the fruit of their what? Their sacrifice. The sacrifice. So sacrifice causes us to experience certain seasons. My cousins, my cousin Rudy, one of the things that he did with his two kids, I remember he you know, his van was older and everything, and I knew the money that my cousin Rudy made. You know, he part owner of the company with his father and everything, and I was like, Rudy, I said, man, I know you can get a van, you know, and everything. He goes, you know what? He goes, but we're paying into our children's college. Man, his daughter, I don't even think is in third grade, and because they started, their whole college, for both of them, is paid for. He had to drive around. He even was driving a van at one point in Florida. Come on, let me tell you something. That's a couple of spots short of hell, you know, on how hot it is over there and stuff. I wasn't cussing. I'm talking about hell literally. You know what I'm saying? It is hot in Florida. Driving with no air. Because his vision was, I'm going to pay my kids school tuition. Sacrifice. He could have been riding in a brand new truck. It's just the sacrifice that he chose. So now what happens later on in his life because of his sacrifice? College is paid for. It's taken care of. He'll coast because of the sacrifice. Come on now. That's good stuff. That's real, real good stuff. Amen. Listen, I'm trying to get you from one place to another. And here's something really important. We do not want to put God in a box. I'm going to give you some things today talking about your season. And what I'm telling you, I'm not trying to give you a cookie cutter. This is the way exactly it's going to happen. Because let me tell you something about God. The minute you try to put him in a box, he's not going to follow everything that you say. You hear what I'm saying? You can't put God in a box. You can't say he's definitely going to do. God is funny. He will do it, but he's going to do it his way. But you got to follow what he's telling you to do. But we have some good guidelines about changing the season in our life. Now listen, the first thing is this. What do we do about a season of disobedience? Now we know that disobedience has consequences, but what do we do when we encounter a season of disobedience? And all of us have been there. We've all been there. But what is the first thing about disobedience? Number one, the first thing we get is instruction. The first thing we get is instruction, and God speaks to us and says, hey, he knocks on your heart. It could be in a church service. It could be a friend telling you. It could be someone encouraging you, but you know what? It could be some form of instruction and saying, you know what? It's time to turn this thing around. So we get instruction, and then number two is restoration. Restoration comes with repentance, right? We go to God and ask God to forgive us. So the minute we ask God to forgive us, praise God, that situation or that thing is in God's hands. We are forgiven. And the minute we say, God, forgive me, we are on the road to changing our season. So instruction number one, two, restoration, and which is repentance. But number three is this, protection. When we come out of a season of disobedience, do you know that God sees you like a lamb? He sees you like a sheep, and he will protect you. The good shepherd will protect you. Listen, when you disobey, God is not looking out to get you. He's not looking out to strike you. But you know what God is trying to do? He's trying to get you up so you can fight for yourself, and he will protect you because that's his heart. Amen. We're talking about what happens in a season of disobedience. It's protection. Number four is building. Do you know that God, if you ever broke a bone in your body, they put a cast on you, and that cast is protecting you. But what's happening as that cast is protecting you is that bone is beginning to fuse together, and that cartilage is beginning to strengthen. And you know what? And that's what God does. He builds you up. He's trying to build you up after that season of disobedience. Number five, spiritual warfare. No matter where, what of the three things we're going to talk about today, you will experience spiritual warfare. But there's a difference of your confidence in each of these seasons. In the area of disobedience, do you know, like when someone receives Jesus Christ or they have a major victory of someone who's like a young Christian, do you know why we should rally around them, give them a call? Hey, how are you? What's going on with you? Because you know what? The enemy will try to pick them off because they're not strong yet. That bone is healing. God will protect them. But you know what? Those influences of the enemy. Listen, I have seen the craziest stuff when a person says, yes, I'm going to surrender to God. I'm going to change the season. Out of nowhere, a crazy girlfriend will call. Out of nowhere. Something easy will come along. Hey, you want to make some quick money? Something compromising, because the enemy is trying to pick you off. We got to be real careful. Spiritual warfare. Obedience. Listen, when we're facing a season of disobedience, God will require obedience. He will require obedience. The part of the season of disobedience and being strengthened to move on to the next level we're going to talk about is we need to obey. We don't want to keep a cycle of disobedience. We don't want to keep opening the door for the enemy. That's the thing sometimes that is so frustrating. Listen, precious God's people that God loves so much, sons and daughters, but they keep repeating the same things over. And you know, you just want to tell them, it's like, hey, listen, you're doing the same thing over. Listen, it's time to strengthen up and obey. Now listen, what are we talking about now? Everyone say preparation. Preparation. I'm not trying to be legalistic to you. I'm just trying to help you that if you ever encounter whatever season that you're in, I want you to remember these things because it will help you. So obedience was number six, you know, when we're facing a season of disobedience. Now listen, the next level, I'm going to call this the next level. Remember, I'm not telling you cookie cutter. I'm not telling you this is exactly the way it goes. But listen, there's another level, and it's called the time of preparation. God is setting you up for a season of harvest. God is setting you up and getting you ready. So what does a time of preparation look like? And listen, a lot of times, and now I'm going to say this to you. I'm going to say this by experience. But in a time of preparation, do you know sometimes God goes quiet on you? He goes stealth mode on you. He goes quiet. You wonder, like, wait a minute. I'm not hearing. I'm like, how come you're not speaking? How come, like, wait, what's going on here? And do you know why sometimes God gets quiet? Because he wants you to press into him. He wants to see what you're going to do when he's quiet. He wants to see, will you come after me even when you don't know exactly what's going on? Will you obey me even when you're just not sure? Will you obey me when the preacher for 4 weeks in a row hasn't given you anything that you feel like you can take for yourself? Will you still obey me? And that is number two, obedience in quietness. Will you obey in quietness? Church, let me tell you what God wants you to do. What was the last thing that he told you to do? What was the last thing? Hi, Naomi, love you. Hi. Hi. Yeah. She loves Pastor, that's a fact. Will you obey God on the last thing that he told you to do? How about this? Have you ever felt like you've done everything but what he told you to do? And do you want to know something? I know you can get mad at God, but to God most of the time, that's not good enough. I told you to do this. And we dance around it. We dance around what he told us to do. Listen. A time of preparation. See, because God has your harvest and your next season in mind, so he's encouraging you now because he sees the end from the beginning and he wants to encourage you. He wants to prepare you. Listen, number three is standing. Standing. Will you do what you know to do? Sometimes, listen, when you're not hearing God, you got to continue to do what you know to do is right. Will you continue to go to church? Will you continue to read your Bible? Will you continue to praise his name? You got to do what you know to do. That little Willie, when he was taken captive, listen, he may have not known a lot of songs, but in his church, they might have been doing that song. He goes, I don't know a lot of songs, but this one song, every praise is to my God. Every word of worship, one accord. Every praise, every praise. And that criminal's telling them, shut up. Shut your mouth. He told me to shut up. So he said, he didn't say nothing, but he began to sing for 3 hours, chasing that devil away. Come on now. That's powerful. Will you stand and do what you know to do? Let me give you number four. In a time of preparation. Listen, this is strong. And this is the key point that I want to focus on. Opening and closing of doors. This is very uncomfortable. This is where major trust comes in. Listen, closed doors in God is not necessarily bad. Closed doors are setups for open doors. And not every open door is a God door. Not every door is not every open door is a God door. Now let me say this to you. Let's just be real. If you, and I'm going to use a job situation. And listen, I believe, and I'm looking around the room, you know, I know we have a couple of new people, but pretty much 98% of the people in this room, we have a relationship. You know me, you know my heart. So I'm going to just be a little strong on this, but we got to be real. If you lost your job and you look at that as a closed door, but you were lazy, you showed up late, you disrespected your boss, it's not a closed door by God. You closed the door. It's just a harvest of your laziness. That's tough. Because here's the scripture that we want to use. All things work together for good to them that love God, that are called according to his purpose. That's not all things working out. That could be God gave you a great job and you jacked it up. So here's what we do. We go to disobedience. Let's get restored. Let's get some good mentors in our life to help us, to show us how to be a good employee. Come on now. And to help us to get back on track. And so when the next open door comes, we will be faithful and we won't repeat the same mistakes. Come on now. God knows what's going on in your life. God knows your company was going to be bought. God knows there was going to be a merger and they were going to try to push their people in and all that stuff. And here you were. But let me tell you something. If you're in God, Father, I'm a tither. I've always put you first. Let me tell you, get ready for an open door. Get ready for, man, listen. You've been walking in a time of preparation. You've been keeping your eyes on the Lord. Get ready because God's word does not return void. He will accomplish what he said he would do in your life. But here's the thing. Some doors are God slamming it shut. And some doors are us slamming it shut. Some relationships are in our life are us jacking it up. And some of them are God saying, you know what? You don't need this person in your life. And just to clarify, because I always got to do it, he's not going to get rid of your husband or your wife. No, listen, I got to be serious with you, because God will never go against his word to perform his will. If you made a covenant, honor your covenant. But there's sometimes people in our life we need to say, you know what, the season for this relationship is over. And you need to be discerning about that, amen? Listen. The closing and opening of doors. Church, can I say this to you? You study it for yourself in Romans chapter 8, the scripture that I just quoted about all things working together for good to them that love God, who are the called according to his purpose. If you study the verses above that lead in the theme of that chapter, you need to study it. Let me tell you what it's talking about. It's talking about being led of the Holy Spirit. Being led. I want to say this to you. If you are led by the Holy Spirit, all things work together for good. Hallelujah. Listen, that's why Pastor Irwin is constantly telling you to build your relationship with the presence of the Holy Spirit. Talk to God. Learn to hear God's voice. Learn to hear what is his voice and what is not, because it will save you so much time. And when he's quiet, I want to challenge you, because I've been there. Press into and say, you know what, God, I have no idea what you're doing or what you're saying, but I love you, and I'm going to press, and I'm going to press, and I'm going to press. That's it. You refuse to quit. You refuse to quit. Hallelujah. Listen, in a time of preparation, number five, you need to trust in God and not in man. You need to learn how to trust God. Trust is easy if you could see it. Trust is hard when you don't see it. Trust in God and not in man. Trust in God and not in man. Number six, this is a time, I love this one. This is a time of clay molding. Clay molding. You ever watch those people? They have that thing that spins around. What is that called? That thing? Pottery wheel. So they have that pottery wheel, and they take nice water, and they take this piece of clay, and they're putting the water, and it's like some of you go back to the movie Ghost, and you know that scene, and it's all nice and lovey-dovey and everything, and it's just this beautiful time of refreshing, you know? And you know, I remember in middle school when we used to work with clay, what did you have to do with your project if you weren't done? You had to put it in a plastic bag and seal it up, and you had to put it in some place cold so that it wouldn't get like all like chalky and junky and stuff. But here's the funny thing. Listen, after you're done with your project and you're using water and it's so nice, do you know that before you can use that thing, do you know what you have to do? You have to put it in the furnace. You got to put it in the furnace. That thing has got to heat up. Hallelujah. It has got to heat up. And let me tell you, the heat will come. Like right now, thank God for the fans. Amen. But the clay molding will take place. Listen, pray in the Spirit. Number seven, pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Spirit. You know, learn how to pray. We're going to be talking about this in the near future. You got to learn how to pray in the Spirit. Do you know the Bible says that when you pray in the Holy Ghost, do you know it says that you pray the mysteries of God? Listen, if you don't know what to pray for in the time or the season of preparation, you need to learn how to pray in the Spirit. When you don't know what to pray for, you just begin to pray in the Spirit. Learn how to pray in the Spirit. Ask God, say, Lord, teach me how to pray in the Holy Ghost. Teach me how to pray in the Spirit. Listen, you may not have words. I don't know if you've ever been there before. You have no words to describe or explain what is going on, but you just begin to pray in the Spirit. Amen? Come on now. Number eight, and this is important. We need to develop the gifts that are in the church, the apostles and the prophets and the pastors and the teachers. Listen, and let me tell you why you need to do that. Do you know that many times a transition of a season, God will send a man or a woman of God a lot of times in a prophetic gift and will give you instruction by the Spirit to change the season in your life. Yes. Happened to me in September. Man of God spoke into my life and said, this is what you need to do. And I've been transitioning from September until right now because of a word that I knew was a Spirit word. The transition from Florida to California. What was that? That was a word from an intercessor saying, hey, what do you think about this church? I was like, nuh-uh. I'm not moving to California. But you know what? God had a season changing. He was preparing me all that time for here. Preparing for a season. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We need to activate those things. Listen, let me get you to this. Now we're going to talk about the season of harvest. The season of harvest. Number one is this. There will be a flow. Church, when I tell you something, when you enter harvest, it is so funny. It seems like every single thing is easy. Don't get used to it, but it seems like every single thing is easy. There is a flow that begins to happen. There is a flow that you got to learn how to jump in and recognize the time of harvest. Recognize that season. Take note of it. Take note of what's going on so that you can, listen, when you're in a time of preparation, remember when you're in the wilderness. Know how it feels to be in the wilderness, because God will put you around people and just say, hey, listen, you'll encourage them, say, hold on. I know you're not hearing God, but just press. He's going to come through. He's going to speak to you. If they're in a season of disobedience, say, hey, brother, hey, sister, listen, just get it right. It's going to be all right. It's going to be good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In a season of harvest and breakthrough, there's clarity. It's amazing how there's clarity when you are in that season. It's just, man, you know exactly what to do. You know exactly where to go. And you know that God is the one that opened it up. You need to know what season that you're in. If you ever have a goal, the same goal could look different for two different types of people. You could start walking in your goal, and all of a sudden, attacks come from everywhere, and you feel like saying, you know what, this definitely is not of God. Well, you could be throwing something away. Listen, sometimes the enemy attacking is just a signpost to let you know you're on the right track. You need to have discernment. Amen? And listen, and sometimes when you're involved in something, it just seems like there's blessing. Listen, if Jesus is first in your life and you're seeing increase, know that you're in a season of harvest and overflow. Breakthrough. Hallelujah. There's momentum. Number three is there's momentum. There's momentum. And so that goes along with the flow. And number four is there is prosperity. There is prosperity. Church, can I tell you something? You need to be very mindful and you need to recognize doors of favor. You need to be very mindful where increase starts to take place in your life. And you begin to start saying, like, all of a sudden weird things happen. Like, this just seems to fall in line. All of a sudden you get blessed here. All of a sudden somebody at the counter says, I don't know why I'm doing this for you, but you need to be mindful of that. Don't just be like, thank you, Jesus. You need to pray. Listen, let me give you one more, even though we're talking about harvest and everything, because we're talking about prosperity. Listen, if you are experiencing, this is good right here. If you're experiencing temptations, like if you're just wondering, like, where the heck did that come from? It's going to be one of two things, period. Listen, because we know that the spirit is willing, but the flesh is what? Weak, right? Listen, it's going to be one of two things. And it's good to examine, like, why am I having these thoughts? Listen, it's going to be one of two things. Number one, A, it's stuff that I deposited in me. So it's just coming out of me. Stuff that I'm going to talk real with the men and stuff like that. If you see a beautiful woman, is there anything sinful about looking at a beautiful woman, recognizing that she's beautiful? No. But you know, one of our pastors talked about the bounce. He said, just bounce, like he said, don't linger there. Don't linger there. Just bounce, okay, bounce, Because what you feed will grow, and what you start, listen. You're going to, listen, out of everything I said, everyone's going to be like, remember the bounce. Just roll with it, just roll with it, just listen. So, listen, you can't, if you see something or whatever, it's like, okay, yeah, that's an attractive, of course for the women, yeah, that's an attractive man or whatever, but you don't just sit there and go, wow. And you just keep looking and, what is it? Wow. No. You just do the bounce. Okay, cool. Because I don't need to feed myself with thoughts of anybody else other than that woman right there. So sometimes, listen, it's being careful about the stuff that we watch too. Because, sometimes we could experience some crazy jacked up thoughts. But what happened was is that you saw something, you allowed yourself to see something super crazy, and now you're having these crazy thoughts. Just be careful. And man, I'm not trying to be religious on you. I'm just trying to, hey, listen, we go to the movies. I watch television. I believe God created TV. Oh, maybe not. I don't know. I'm just going to, listen, I watch TV. Listen, but you got to be careful what you watch. Right, church? Come on, let's just be careful. But listen, so what's the other thing if you're experiencing a lot of temptations? Is it sometimes just physical and natural? Let's just say it's on the carnal side or the lustful side. Yeah, the Bible says, hey, listen, if you burn, it's time to get married. Just clear as day. If you burn, God, send me my husband, send me my wife, you know what I'm saying? Because I'm burning. Listen, but the other thing, a lot of times, it's just like, wait a minute, I'm reading my word. I'm going to church and, man, I'm praising God and it just seems like I'm getting these attacks many times. And I, it's one of the mysteries. How can he know what's going on? And I've heard it taught, which is really good, where because the enemy knows your patterns. And I believe in the realm of the spirit, the enemy can sense when God is stirring up something, when he's getting ready to release blessing. And there's nothing like an enemy coming to try to tempt you and try to get you off course. And you gotta be aware of that. In church, do you know that in everything that I said, there's two things that I just want you to come out with? Listen, in every season that you go through, even if you went through a season of disobedience, can I say this to you? If you put Christ first, if you seek after his face, whatever season that you're in is going to be easier than what you think. If you just put him first. If you're in a season of overflow, don't get focused on the overflow. Keep your eyes on the one who is the one pouring out the flow. Don't get focused like, oh yeah, harvest, harvest, harvest. Recognize what it is. Church, I know that's, you know that there was a season that I remember. Do you know like in your checkbook, they give you a certain amount of checks and then they give you all these deposit slips? There was a season in my life where I was using more deposit slips than I was checks. I was depositing money like crazy. Amen. And then there was a time where all I was doing was writing checks. Yeah. We go through seasons. But what God wants us to do is be mindful. Hey, do you remember when you were doing those deposits? Were you thinking ahead? I remember this one friend of ours, Jimmy. He lives in New Jersey now and stuff. He was a cook. And he used to work at a country club. And Jimmy would work in Florida because this is the season. So Jimmy would work from October to April. May, June, July, and August, he was off. Why was he off? Because all the snowbirds went back up north, so there wasn't that much work. So guess what Jimmy had to do? He had to prepare for the 4 months that he would not be receiving income. What would happen if he did not prepare? He would have been in trouble. We need to prepare. We need to recognize our seasons. Let's stand to our feet right now. Hallelujah. Praise God. I appreciate the spirit that's in the house today. And I just want to pray with you right now. We always give a moment to activate the word of God in our life. So I just want you to just take a moment, bow your head, close your eyes for a moment. And I don't know what season that you're in right now, but I want to pray for you. Because here's the thing, God knows the season that you're in. And in this church as a whole, we are preparing for a season of harvest. We are preparing for God to do great and mighty things in this place. But you know what? He's going to do great and mighty things in your life. So, Father, we just, right now, whatever season that we're in, Father God, we just submit ourselves to you, Father God. God, we want to hear you, and we want to prepare correctly. Lord, give me discernment to know where I am and where I'm going. Help me to realize, God, that in your kingdom, it's a powerful thing to plant seeds towards my future. Father, I thank you right now for each and every person, Lord, that you will bring instruction into their life, that you will bring clarity into their life, that you will show them, Father God, if there's anyone in a season of disobedience, show them how to get into a season of preparation. And God, if there's a person in a season of preparation where things have just been quiet and it just seems like, man, God, I'm discouraged. I feel like I'm not hearing you. Lord, right now we ask you to give them strength and show them, Father, the light at the end of the tunnel, Lord. God, give them a kiss from heaven and let them know that they're on the right track, Lord God, and that you're going, God, to do great and mighty things in their life, and that the season of increase and the season of breaking through that level is going to happen. In the name of Jesus. Father, if there's anyone in a season, Father God, of increase, in a season of harvest where there's breakthrough, Father, we rejoice with them. We fan that flame. We ask you, Lord God, that you would speak to them in the middle of their harvest, that you would speak to them and show them, Lord God, how to multiply what they have and how, Father God, how to help others experience harvest and breakthrough, Father. Use them, Father, to encourage others. We give you praise. But Father, in every season, in everything that we do, Lord, help us to be people of preparation. not legalistic, not religious, Lord, not held in bondage, always afraid, like, did I do this wrong? Did I do that wrong? But no, Lord, help us to sit there and say, God, I don't quite understand where I am, but Lord, I'm submitting myself to you. Help me in my season, God. Lord, we thank you for seasons of change in the house. Seasons of change. Seasons of change. Give us discernment. Speak to our life, Father. Speak to our life. If you're in this house this morning and you say, you know what, Pastor, I got to get things right with the Lord. Before I even focus on any season, I need to make sure that things are right between me and God. And if that's you this morning, I just want you right now to slip up your hand and say, God, just I just get it right with you. 1, 2, 3, just put your hand up. We're going to pray with you. God bless you, EJ. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Amen. I want to pray with those that lifted up their hand in church. I'm going to ask you to help me to pray with our family. Amen. Let's all pray this together, especially those of you that lifted up your hand. I want you to pray this, but we're all going to pray it with you. Let's pray. Say, Father God, I submit myself to you. Forgive me for doing wrong. I give you everything. Jesus, you're the Son of God. You died for me. And because of you, my season is changing for the better. Come into my life. Make me new. I repent. I turn from any wicked ways. I submit myself to you. I want to live for you, Lord. Help me to do that. Strengthen me with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name.